Hey guys, Boo here, cutting in before the video. When I started this series, it was supposed to be not as involved and closer in style to Masako X's What If Dragon Ball videos. However, things have since gotten away from me. I've introduced characters to help explore Galen since he's a bit one-note because he had his arc in The Force Unleashed. However, I've kind of started to lose the initial premise I set out under. The ideas I have in mind for the future go a bit too far off the rails, and I want to get back on track. Having said that, for the next 2 to 5 videos, I'm going to jump ahead to the original Star Wars trilogy and show what Galen could have added to that dynamic if he survived. Basically, I want to wrap things up and give a satisfying conclusion. Having said that, I may continue this story under a different name that follows Galen and his adventures during and possibly after the Galactic Civil War. It depends on how this, ends. Follow up on loose threads I won't be addressing from here on out, essentially. We'll probably call it something like Legendary Rebels or have it be along those lines, and have it follow up on Filoni Clone Wars lore, which the old EU could never quite explore on account of how things just worked out. If anything, this took a while to come out because I was trying to figure out what direction I wanted to take things, and this is what I've chosen. There may not be a follow-up series, I want to make that clear, but if there is, it will be a companion to this one. But with that said, I hope you all enjoy. Former younglings, now grown and world-weary, have reclaimed the mantle they once cast aside. Lost Padawans, searching for purpose, have stepped out of the shadows to fight for the fallen. Broken Knights, terrified of what lays before them, have mustered the strength to finally move forward. Though the Order is not as it once was, disorganized and lacking leadership, the Jedi have returned. Nearly 4 years after the Battle of Raxus, the tides of the Galactic Civil War have begun to turn. The destruction of the Death Star and the Empire's barbarity toward Alderaan had galvanized many into joining the Alliance's cause, yet the conflict's end was still so very distant. With the death of Bail Organa, the key mediator between Mothma and Iblis, discord and division almost saw the fragile collection of rebels fracture and split. Yet this would not come to pass. Lux Bonteri, a leader and hero in his own right, had come to fill the void the proud senator left vacant. Like his mother before him, the aging man no one could call a boy had become a voice of reason in chaotic times. With Galen's aid, a man whose trust was no longer in question, the Alliance remained whole. Mon Mothma would provide soldiers, Garm Iblis, ships, and weapons. Galen Marek would speak for the fledgling Jedi Order, with Lux Bonteri leading them all forward, toward the dream of the Republic. With the base finally away from the Empire's prying eyes, the Rebellion regained its footing after the tumultuous period of conflict which followed the Battle of Yavin. For Ziel Noor and Anakin Bonteri, students of the famed Jedi Knight Galen Marek, this stretch of time had become an exhausting one. The crew of the Rogue Shadow had been on the front lines of every major engagement against the Empire for nearly 3 years. They were tired. Hoping for a moment's reprieve, the battered band of Jedi touched down upon the frozen world of Hoth, home to the Alliance's headquarters, Echo Base. Being the first to exit, Galen inhales deeply, the planet's frigid air gently burning his lungs, and sighs softly. The years spent fighting had aged him greatly. He was no longer a young man. "Damn it, CL!" Anakin's voice echoed from the Rogue Shadow. "Get your ass moving!" Sounds of a struggle emanated from the ship's hold. It was by no means serious, but most certainly forceful. Upon hearing it, Galen couldn't help but smirk. "But it's cold," the Quarren whined. "I hate the cold." "Yeah, I know, but you gotta grin and bear it." As the Togruta's words reached Galen's ears, a sharp squeal from Ziel echoed throughout the hangar. With proud confidence and a bashful Quarren in his arms, Anakin took his place beside the Jedi Knight.
"Chuff-sucking fool,"
Ziel pouted, avoiding eye contact with her assailant. Setting the girl down, the Togruta looked to her with his one remaining eye and gave a wry smile. come on. You can't stay mad at me forever, Anakin insisted. You're a real jerk-ass, Annie. Ziel fired back, her gaze fixed to the ground. From his post, a rebel private watches this peculiar display play out. These are Jedi? He asked his comrade in utter bewilderment, only to get a shrug in response. It's been a while, hasn't it? A familiar voice echoed from the hangar's far side. It has, Galen called out in response. The boy's been a... he's been a handful. Ahsoka, with a young man in tow, approaches the trio and stops before Anakin. With the ground level beneath them, the woman finds herself in a situation she did not expect. She was looking up at her son. He'd gotten taller. You've grown, Ahsoka states, matter of fact. Anakin's muscles were sizable and well-defined, his body riddled in scars. Much like his mentor, the war had turned the boy into a man. Keeping the lids of his empty eye sockets shut, the Togruta wrapped his robotic and intact arm both around his mother. You have no idea. For a while, a silence fell upon the hangar as the two embraced. Not exactly knowing what to do, Galen ran his fingers through his shallow beard before locking eyes with the one who had followed Ahsoka. Letting his gaze wander, the Jedi spotted a lightsaber which dangled from the man's belt. Take it you're her student, he inquired. Name's Galen Marek. Luke Skywalker, he said simply. Immediately upon hearing that name, the Jedi shot Ahsoka a glance. There was but a nod in response. However, the silent gesture spoke volumes. She knew who he was. Ahsoka, Ziel interjected as Anakin pulled away from his mother. This, belongs to you. The Quarren, no longer the frightened girl she used to be, handed the Jedi back her Shoto. It was yours to keep, the Togruta's calm voice uttered softly. It was never mine to begin with, Ziel explained. I need to move on. Galen chuckled softly to himself, much to Ahsoka's mild irritation. Can't rely on others forever, the Jedi began. Sometimes you have to stand upon your own 2 feet, alone. With her free hand, the girl unhooked a lightsaber of her own creation and activated its yellow blade. The weapon's golden hue and faint hum radiated a warmth which even those unfamiliar with the Force could feel. It was a bizarre experience for most, as if the crystal reflected the Quarren's personality. Then, with wide-eyed wonder, Ziel looked to Ahsoka, expectantly. All right, I'll take it back, she finally relented. But if you need it, it's yours. We know, Anakin added, moving toward the base's interior. Now, let's continue this reunion somewhere a bit warmer. Colds make my arm ache. Before venturing through the winding tunnels of Echo Base, Galen stops short and catches Ahsoka's arm. With their students no longer in earshot, the Jedi looks to the woman, an intense glare carved into his face, awaiting an answer. I haven't told him, she whispered. I don't know how. Figure it out, he snapped. The longer you wait, the worse it gets. Galen loosens his grip and lets go of the Togruta, bringing an end to his momentary fit of aggression. If I was him, I'd want to know, the man's voice echoed throughout the hall. Ahsoka remained silent and nodded to herself. It was a subject she tried to broach numerous times in the past, only to come up short. In a furious huff, Leia Organa marched down the hallway, in the Jedi's general direction. Upon spotting Galen, she momentarily stopped, only to state, Juno's in the command center, before continuing on her way. What's, eating her? Ahsoka quipped, relieving the air's lingering tension. Lover's quarrel, I imagine. The Jedi fired back. Well, here's hoping you have better luck. The Togruta smirked and took her leave, the pair going their separate ways. Stepping into Echo Base's main ops center, Galen entered a world he had become all too familiar with. The otherwise pitch darkness of the room was interrupted and illuminated by the Alliance's numerous computers and holoprojectors. The place was abuzz with foot traffic, the staff seemingly in a perpetual panic as they ran to and from every which direction. If it wasn't for the Jedi's more acute senses, he'd have figured this was the natural state of things. However, he knew better. Marek! Admiral Eclipse called out, waving him over. Receiving nods from busy command staff as he walked by, Galen joined an ongoing strategy meeting alongside General Carlist Reekin, Echo Base's commanding officer. The Empire's found us, haven't they? The Jedi added immediately upon joining the group. Quick as ever, Commander, affirmed Reekin. My students and I can handle whatever's coming. Just put us where we're needed. I figured you'd say that, Juno uttered, a look of defeated acceptance etched into her face. We're done here for now. We've done all that we can, declared the general. Admiral, you know the commander best. I suggest you take what little time is left and brief him in private. Without saying another word, Reekin stepped away and took his leave. Finally alone, and in Juno's quarters, Galen holds the woman close as she rests her wary head against his chest. We never have enough time, she whispered softly. Reluctantly, the Jedi agreed. No. No, we don't. With one finger gently extended, Juno traced a scar which ran from Galen's neck to his lips. A new one? Questioned her waning voice. Old, he confided. At least a year. The woman pulled back and caressed the Jedi's cheek. I like the beard. Galen brushed Juno's hair aside, exposing more of her pale face. I love your lack of one, the man joked. You're an ass, she shot back amidst a laugh. In that fleeting moment of calm, the pair enjoyed each other's company and wished for it to never end. Yet, in spite of their own desires, the drums of war grew louder. The Empire's inevitable attack drew closer. Taking to the field alongside his students, Galen gripped the hilt of his lightsaber and prepared for what was to come. Spotting the first set of Imperial AT-ATs, the commander ducked into a neighboring trench and awaited his moment to strike. The vicious dogfights which played out in the sky, the unrelenting artillery fire, and sheer amount of ordnance being thrown around made those who had yet to see a Jedi in action question their usefulness. Could they truly alter the course of a battle which already seemed doomed? Then, as if to answer that question, a Rebel snowspeeder piloted by Luke Skywalker brought down one of the towering transports with its tow cable. After a well-placed shot, the hulking monstrosity exploded to the tune of cheers from those on the ground. With other Rebel craft following suit and going for the AT-AT's legs, stormtroopers began deploying sooner than expected. Much to their disadvantage, however, the vast, icy expanse of Hoth's landscape stood between the Imperials and the Alliance's trenches. They were exposed, with nowhere to go but forward. Despite getting torn to shreds, the might of the Empire came crashing down upon the Rebel position like a tidal wave. Imperial commanders counted on the possibility of Jedi being present, therefore they ensured their numbers would be enough to overpower whatever or whoever they encountered. The distance between the Empire and Alliance's positions nearly closed. Galen looked to Anakin and nodded. Together, they rushed toward the approaching horde, lightsabers activated, and began tearing them to pieces. Their ferocious ferocity, the sheer levels of violence which the pair fought with, made Imperials at the rear of the charge stop dead in their tracks. They were terrified, yet were unable to retreat, for something far more frightening than Jedi loomed behind them. Catching the crimson flash of a lightsaber bisect a snowspeeder in two, Galen realized full well Vader was on Hoth. Charging past the Imperials and cutting down any which got in his way, the commander left the defense of Echo Base to his students, as he himself pursued the Sith Lord. Recovering from a sudden crash landing, Luke looks to his co-pilot, only to see that his speeder had been cut in half, sensing a dark aura bearing down upon him. As if it was pressing on his chest, the young Jedi in training kicks his cockpit open and forces himself out. lightsaber in hand, Luke immediately comes to understand he's out of his depth, for Darth Vader, silent and unmoving, stood before him. Igniting his father's blade, the brave yet foolish young man attacked the Sith Lord, only to watch as his opponent effortlessly deflected the oncoming strikes. The fight wasn't a serious one, as if Vader was toying with Luke, testing him. Frustrated and feeling slighted, the Jedi in training reached out with the Force and threw the remains of a snowspeeder at the black-clad enemy. Feet firmly planted, Vader vertically cut the debris in two before it made contact. However, this was merely a distraction. Using the speeder to shield his movements, Luke closed the distance on his enemy and through the newly created opening, landed a kick which sent the Sith Lord reeling. "That's for Ben," Luke thought to himself. The young Jedi's movements, his power, caught the Sith Lord by surprise. Someone other than Obi-Wan had been training him, but who? Before he could come to an answer or get his bearings, Luke tore into Vader's side with the azure blade of an all-too-familiar weapon. Seeing the young man's next strike cut through the air toward his head, the Sith Lord took a step back, evading it, and went on the defensive.
"I'll make you pay for killing my father,"
Luke began as he wailed on Vader, an unprotected thought worming its way into his mind and compromising his calm. Letting one hand go free, the young man reached for his blaster and repeatedly fired while darting backward. He then chucked his sidearm at the Sith Lord and overloaded its power cell with the Force, creating an explosion and opening which Luke looked to exploit. With guilt and hatred foreign to the Jedi weighing heavily upon him, the young man wrapped his hands around the hilt of his weapon and charged.
"For killing my mother,"
Luke howled, uncertain as to when or even how he came to know that. Like a raging storm, Vader rushed forward toward Luke, catching him by surprise. No longer playing around, the Sith Lord cut the young man's dominant hand clean off before grabbing him by the face and slamming him into the ground. Alongside the pain which came with such an assault, Luke could feel a horrific darkness, a suffering ebb off of Vader he had never encountered before. For a time, the pair stay as they are, while the Battle of Hoth plays out around them. As if trapped within that moment, they hear and feel nothing. Despite his training, the young Jedi had, for but a second, given into anger. He wondered, in the odd haze he found himself in, if those emotions were truly his and his alone. Letting go, the Sith Lord rose to his feet and stared at his badly beaten son. He felt so cold, a symptom perhaps of an approaching blizzard. The wind was whining, crying far more than usual. Something was coming, or maybe it had already left. Then, upon hearing the ignition of a lightsaber, Vader turned to meet his gaze to that of Galen's. "Get away from him," the Jedi ordered, blade poised for a fight. Across the battlefield, back toward the Alliance's fortifications, the Rebels had begun to give ground. The Imperial onslaught was simply too much to handle. The fighting had devolved into an intense melee, with ideas of honor or even humanity thrown to the wayside amidst combat far too common in the days of the Galactic Civil War. Her back to Anakin's, blaster raised and on the brink of overheating, Ziel felt a chill she hadn't experienced since the death of her father. "It's cold," the Quarren stated simply. Anakin removed his vermilion blade from the chest of a fallen stormtrooper. "Pay it no mind," he directed. "We're together. We'll make it out of this." Throwing aside her now defunct pistol, Ziel ignited her lightsaber, and with Anakin heading the opposite direction, rushed into an approaching squad of Imperial soldiers in a desperate bid to give the Alliance more time. She wasn't as skilled as her teacher or even the Togruta, but was one to not be taken lightly. In the trench's close quarters, the servants of the Empire didn't stand a chance. The Quarren hacked her foes to literal pieces. She fought with a ferocity that, though subtle, was terrifying in its own right. In spite of the violent display, however, onlookers, other rebels who fought at her back, felt the girl's sense of spirit, her defiance rise in their chest and grant them a courage they may not otherwise have. Though the situation was desperate, the middle of the Alliance's line, where the fighting was thickest, refused to give in. They'd fight for as long as they had to, even if it meant to the death. Anakin, however, was a physical force of nature, and in all ways, say appearance, the spitting image of his teacher. The Togruta fought passionately and allowed his feelings to guide his hand. They didn't control him like they had all those years ago on Raxus, but provided clarity. He knew who he was, why he was fighting, and who he wanted to protect. He longed for the dream his father spoke of, an era of peace free of the cruelty he knew all too well. Spotting an AT-AT nearly trampling the rebel position, Anakin took matters into his own hands and dashed toward the hulking monstrosity. Using a grappling hook built into his arm, the young Jedi latched onto the machine and ascended to its head. Once in range, he carved a hole into the command section and dispatched its operators. Before long, he turned the Walker's weapons upon the Imperials and in the chaos that followed, granted an opening for Alliance forces to withdraw. "Everyone pull back," Ziel ordered to those still fighting. "Get to the transports. We'll hold them off." The girl's directive and the display before them shocked the rebel soldiers. "These are Jedi," one private whispered to another. Amidst the fleeting reprieve, members of the Alliance spoke to each other in hushed tones and came to an understanding. "They're not leaving without you," Anakin's voice cracked over the comms. "Get going. I won't be far behind." "But," the girl tried to plead. "Damn it, ZL, get your ass moving," he interrupted. "Just grin and bear it, I'll be fine." In the distance, the Quarren could spot the beginnings of another Imperial assault quickly approaching.
"You're a real jerkass, Annie,"
ZL stated softly, looking toward the commandeered AT-AT. There was a long pause, followed by a tender sigh.
"I know,"
he admitted.
"Now, get going."
Reluctantly, the young Jedi called the retreat and left Anakin to his own devices. The Battle of Hoth was drawing to its end. With most of the transports away, Ahsoka abandoned the command center to make for her ship, for she could sense Vader's presence, and more pressing, Luke's distress. Thanks to those in Rogue Squadron and the Alliance's numerous fighter wings, the skies above Hoth were virtually cleared of any possible threats. Following her intuition, the Togruta came upon her student. However, the situation was a dire one. Galen had engaged Vader in a duel. Imperial forces were closing in on their position, and Luke was doing something. His sole remaining arm was outstretched toward the darkening horizon, as if reaching for someone. Ahsoka herself, however, could have sworn she saw some sort of apparition approach her student, but she couldn't say for sure. It vanished as quick as it came. Opening up on her former master with the ship's cannons, the Togruta created an opening for Galen to escape. Wasting no time, the Jedi disengaged from his opponent, grabbed a hold of Luke, and leapt aboard as quickly as he could. Though the approaching Imperials returned fire, the ship made a break for the atmosphere before any damage of note could be sustained. Then, like a broken recording, Luke began to utter a single word as Galen carried him to the medbay. He uttered the name of a remote system. Dagobah.